Welcome. My name is Rob Henneke. I'm the General Counsel and the Litigation Director of the Center for the American Future. And I'm very pleased to welcome you here today to our panel discussion of mission accomplished, what should happen after a protected species under the Endangered Species Act recovers. Small bit of housekeeping matters. This panel discussion has been accredited by the State Bar of Texas for continuing legal education. If you're one of my brethren attorneys and are in need of free CLE credit, the sign-up sheet is in the back and we will submit your name, make sure that you get credit for this course. Just briefly, what I'd like to do is introduce our litigation center since we were brand new to the Texas Public Policy Foundation. Beginning of this year, the foundation decided to create a litigation center, recognizing that so much of what is policy is no longer being made in the legislative branch. You have so much of policy being created at the judiciary. You have so much of policy being created through the executive agencies and the promulgation of rules. And so the leadership here at the foundation made the decision to create a litigation center to be proactive in seeking to assert the 10th Amendment through judicial opposition to government overreach and abuse in subject matter areas of environmental law, private property, and business autonomy rights. And so we're proactive in looking for ways to stand for the Constitution and to advance liberty in representing individuals who are threatened with government overreach, and also to be proactive in identifying case concepts to challenge the constitutionality and legality of some of the government action that we see occurring all the day. And so at our website, AmericanFuture.com, I would encourage you to join in and see the important work that we're doing. But our discussion here, very important, it's part of the work that we're doing at the Center for the American Future in focusing on the Endangered Species Act. And I'll introduce them more in depth here in a moment, but I'd like to welcome our panelists. We have the Honorable Susan Combs with us. We have Adam Zerrenner with the United States Fish and Wildlife Service. And we have Mr. Perry Pendley from the Mountain States Legal Foundation. So real quick, would you help me welcome our panelists here today? By way of a few introductory remarks, you know, when Congress passed the Endangered Species Act in 1973, it did so in recognizing that our rich natural heritage is of, quote, aesthetic, ecological, educational, recreational, and scientific value to our nation and its people. And Congress further expressed concern that many of our nation's native plants and animals were in danger of becoming extinct. And in fact, in his statement made on signing the Endangered Species Act, it was President Nixon that stated, quote, nothing is more priceless and more worthy of preservation than the rich array of animal life with which our country has been blessed. It is a many-faceted treasure of value to scholars, scientists, nature lovers alike, and it forms a vital part of the heritage we all share as Americans. The purpose of the Endangered Species Act is to protect and recover imperiled species and the ecosystems upon which they depend. The law's stated ultimate goal is that of recovery for species so that they no longer need protection under the Endangered Species Act. Since the ESA's adoption nearly 40 plus years ago, over 2,100 species have been listed for protection. And yet in the same time frame, approximately 31 species of the 2,100 plus have ever been delisted from regulation. So with the ESA's goal of recovery being accomplished for only approximately 1% of species being listed, the question arises, does the endangered species work? And also, one must consider that the ESA was enacted within the framework of the United States Constitution. Our federal government is one of enumerated powers found in Article 1, Section 8. And in summary, Congress may exercise the powers only that the Constitution grants it. Now, the basis for the Endangered Species Act is the Commerce Clause, giving Congress the powers to regulate commerce among the several states. These powers are supposedly limited. As recognized by the Ninth Circuit Justice Alex Kaczynski, the Commerce Clause is not the, hey, you can do whatever you feel like clause. So, since the ESA derives its authority from the Commerce Clause, what should be the limitations of the Endangered Species Act? This panel will focus on efforts to address the delisting of species from the Endangered Act that are no longer threatened with extinction, and also address and speak to the limits upon the federal government's constitutional authority to regulate intrastate species under the Endangered Species Act. As part of my litigation center, just recently, we filed a lawsuit that challenges the federal government's authority to regulate a tiny cave spider that only exists within Texas, has no commerce value, and is not bought or sold in interstate commerce. Should that interstate cave spider be something that's regulated by the federal government? You know, it is important that valid science plays a significant role in making the ESA listing decisions, and this panel will also discuss, you know, opposition to the lessening of any of the ESA regulations despite some of the current objective scientific studies. With that being said, it's my privilege to introduce our first panelist, the Honorable Susan Combs. Ms. Combs served the state of Texas as an assistant district attorney, state representative, the 10th Texas Agricultural Commissioner, and the Texas Comptroller and Treasurer. And Ms. Combs currently serves as a principal of Texans for Positive Economic Prosperity, and it was her insistence on good data that served as a hallmark of her terms as state representative, Texas's first woman ag commissioner, and Texas comptroller. Please help me welcome Susan Combs.
Well, I'm delighted to be here. Thank you so much, Rob, and looking forward to the discussion. I'm gonna sort of take this from a kind of a particular sequence of events. I first got interested in endangered species a long time ago, back near my ranch in the Big Bend, the little aguja pondweed near Balmoray, and that was back in about 1986 or 87, and I won't belabor it, but it was an interesting project. And then became a legislator, and then in 96, I worked for then U.S. Senator Kay Hutchison. We dealt a lot with Fort Hood and the golden-cheeked warbler and the black-capped vireo. And at the time, you had a conflict between ranchers wanting to graze on the installation and folks who thought that they were going to be in conflict. Well, I worked on that on her behalf and began to really get a sense of some of the conflicts that maybe could be avoided if we got smarter about it. Became ag commissioner, and I was approached by the ranchers around Fort Hood and said, we've got to solve this problem. We have lost about 47,000 acres of training ground on the installation. The mitigation ratio, if you lost a bird, was 4 to 1, and it didn't seem to make sense. So I said, well, let's come up with a smarter answer where the goal isn't sort of no net loss like wetlands, it is actually to recover the bird. And based on that, we put together a coalition to create the recovery credit system. And it was private and voluntary, and what happened was if the Army needed to burn up some habitat for the tank or something, they had made a deal, like the U.S. Department of Agriculture Conservation Reserve Program, that they would pay the outlying ranchers not to burn up anything so that your habitat loss was maintained and, in fact, increased. And what happened was that we ended up having so many people compete to get on that actually the price was dropped by about half, and we were able to demonstrate that the birds were in lots and lots of places, and so they rolled back the loss of acreage from about 47,000 down to about 8,000 or 9,000. So from a species perspective, it was clearly positive. From a relationship perspective, the defense installation and the Department of Defense and the national defense of this country was working, and the birds were being protected. And so we set that up in about 2005 and 6, and it became kind of a national model. The ranchers created cowbird traps so that the cowbirds were not parasitizing the nests and that the warblers and the vireos would do great. Well, then I became comptroller, and it was a little different lens. I went from the ag side to the economic side, and what was happening was that people were becoming very frightened of the potential imposition of some kind of unknown, understood regulatory framework, And they got frightened. And so the legislature created something called the Interagency Task Force on Economic Benefit and Endangered Species and asked the comptroller to be the presiding officer. Well, there was an interesting project that came up. We had started to analyze all of these species that were listed and sort of trying to find out what was next. Well, there came to our attention that the Fish and Wildlife Service was going to propose listing the dune sagebrush lizard, which hangs around in about five counties out near Midland, Odessa. And at the time, the only analysis that we had seen, they had been studied some in New Mexico and really not in Texas, was that they might exist in about three locales. Well, data is very, very important. And Rob mentioned the data. And we did not think that the scientific basis had been well vetted, that it had been well documented or well studied. And so folks got together and hired 21 biologists, the same biologists that had done the necessary research in New Mexico, and their work had been accepted as being credible. And over about a 6 weeks period, they went and checked every place. It was on the ground. This was not modeling. And I'm saying it's not modeling because that makes a big difference. If you actually go and look, that is different than saying, I think. I think they might be there. I think they might not be there. They went and looked, and they did an exhaustive survey from about June the 1st till July the 1st or June the 10th, 6 weeks before these lizards kind of go dark for the summer. And they found them in 28 spots, which meant then the original data had not been complete. And what we decided to do was, because it was so important that the economic activity in the Permian Basin coexist peacefully with the species, we had to deal with a potential listing, and that's a serious statute. And what we decided to do was to try to see if we could bring everybody together, and I was asked to take on the effort of the Texas Conservation Plan, which we did, and we had a lot of smart help. We had agriculture at the table, we had oil and gas at the table, we had groups in conservation at the table, and we set up a plan that was voluntary, market-driven, and allowed for confidentiality in order to comply with a state statute that had passed. The state statute said, you may not reveal the name of the people who are going to engage in these conservation practices. But we had to assure that there was going to be a way to verify behavior. And so we hired satellite companies. We had a lot of satellite imagery. And we were able to, without giving a particular location, like it's not this location right here because we didn't show the roads, but we knew when somebody did something, and it was an excellent project. Well, somebody sued after we got the plan and said that, no, it won't pass muster. Well, we won in court in the federal district court in the District of Columbia. And, in fact, the opinion went to some length to state that the reason that this species should not be listed, which it was not listed, was because, A, there was such verification in there. The data was excellent. They talked several times about the quality of the science on this, which we thought was important. And so that was great. Well, that taught me, well, what's happened? Where is there other scientific money that is trusted and verifiable? And so I got the legislature to establish a $5 million science fund, and I set up a process as comptroller to have all state universities, we got together, they wrote the paperwork to designing how to administer these grants. We said we will give money for species if they don't know anything, if there's time to get the data, and if the economic impact is huge. Well, the Permian Basin is a hugely important section of the state, as is the Eagle Ford, and we were trying to assign state dollars in the most efficient place. Well, we had to go ahead and get that research, and so we ended up with my successor winning, going ahead and get some more money. So what kind of does this mean? What this means is that Fish and Wildlife Service has had some struggles dealing with the resource issues that they've got. There was, since 2007, 1,300 separate species have been petitioned for listing, which is nearly as many in the prior 30 years. I don't know of any federal agency that can keep up with that kind of a load. And so that was why I thought that the science data, the science fund, was critically important. Well, back to the warbler. I had been dealing with the warbler in 1996 with Senator Hutchison, and then when we set the recovery credit system, and we had thought there was a lot of really good information, and we filed, I individually and as head of Texans for Positive Economic Policy, filed a petition on June the 29th to delist the golden cheek warbler. Rob started off and said, well, what's the process if you think you should be delisting? Well, the answer is, if Fish and Wildlife and everybody else doesn't have the resources because of 1,300 petitions to deal with some of these, are there some that are ready to be taken off because there are structures in place to ensure their continued recovery and thriving and give you time to deal with some that really are at risk? And Fish and Wildlife Service sent me an answer, mid-July, I don't remember the date. And it basically said, we are so overwhelmed by our multi-district litigation settlements, we don't know if we can ever address your petition. Well, that is a really interesting catch-22. So if you plug the system up with a lot of petitions, then how do you ever get to a petition? Because, in fact, it's plugged up, and they already had assigned dates. Well, I then filed a notice of intent to sue, a 60-day notice, on October the 13th, and I supplemented our petition December the 11th. And what is, I've now gotten a response back that says, yes, we will receive your petition, we will look at it, and we will, in fact, give you an answer sometime in May. I'm very encouraged. I don't know what they'll decide about the petition. I don't have any way of knowing. What I do know is that they're going to take a look at it. I have the information. I think it is good, but I'm willing to take my chances with a thorough, careful review, which I believe that the folks will do at Fish and Wildlife. I believe we've given them a lot of good stuff. But what I want to mention is the process itself is so horrible. You get your first petition. They say, "Now we can't ever get to you, because we're already backed up." You then have to file a notice of intent to sue, which is sort of escalating it. And I think that's a terrible, I think it's a terrible situation for any agency where their goal in the original statute was to recover. Recover leads to delisting, if in fact the data is right. So what I would say is that we believe with our warbler information that it is actual ground data. It is not modeled. It is actual. When they first listed the bird, going back today, that's 24-year-old data. It was weak at the time, not thoroughly vetted at the time, but there's been a huge amount of work done by Texas A&M and others, and I'm a big fan of A&M, even though I must say I went to UT, so it's okay. I can be nice about them. But the point is, I'm a big fan of going on the ground, going and taking a look. I don't know of anybody that I have met in the last 15 years who wants to harm a single endangered species or a species that's not listed. I do not know of anybody that wants to do that. What I do know is that people want a transparent, a fair, and an understandable process with a shot at getting solid data given a solid look. And so that's where I am. I'm a wild-eyed optimist. I wouldn't have been in agriculture for so many years if I weren't a raving optimist, because maybe it'll rain tomorrow. But anyway, I just want to say we'll see what happens in May. Thank you, Rob.
Thank you, Susan. And next in our panel, I'm very excited to introduce Mr. Adam Zerrenner. Mr. Zerrenner is a field supervisor for the Austin Ecological Services Field Office with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. And this office has Endangered Species Act responsibility for Central and West Texas. Mr. Zerrenner has worked in the field of environmental policy and natural resource management for more than 20 years. And he received his bachelor's degree from Cornell University and a master's degree from the University of Vermont in Natural Resources, and a master's in Business Administration from the University of Texas at Austin, McCombs School of Business, another UT alum. Please help me welcome Mr. Zerrenner.
All righty. Well, thank Thank you, Rob. I'm going to try not to sound too much like a broken record coming after Ms. Combs, but going to highlight a number of similar type of accomplishments that have occurred here in Texas. The first map, this was from a recent publication last year in the Proceedings in the National Academy of Sciences, and I thought it was a fascinating publication, because you know what they showed was the overlap of biodiversity hotspots and public lands. And what I, you know, what you see is that in Texas there's a lot of biodiversity. And when I first read the article, I was actually pretty grouchy, because I looked at that and I said, you know, there is so much going on here in the state of Texas, and there's so much pride and stewardship to private lands, the state's natural history, heritage, and I'm actually still thinking about writing an article in response to that. But the point is, Texas is blessed with a very rich biodiversity, and a lot is going on to conserve it. Ms. Combs, you know, pointed out, or you know, discussed the case study of the dune sagebrush lizard. I won't go into very much detail about it, other than through voluntary programs, both in New Mexico and here in Texas, Fish and Wildlife Service ultimately made a decision to not list the species. So, a success story.
It's a very cute lizard.
Another one that you all have probably heard about, the Georgetown salamander. So a case where Fish and Wildlife Service, you know, this salamander located just in Williamson County north of us, we proposed it as endangered, worked with the city of Georgetown. They came up with water quality best management practices, ultimately downlisted it to threatened, and came up with a 4D rule that exempted anyone who used those best management practices to enhance water quality and benefit the species. So good situation of providing streamlined process, regulatory certainty for the business community, as well as setting measures in place that are beneficial to the species. And I think that's, you know, going to be the theme of what I talk about here in conjunction with also local community solutions. Concho water snake, found in the headwaters just upstream of us, species listed, I believe, back in the 80s, I believe it was 86, very controversial at the time. Through a combination of additional scientific information as well as conservation actions, ultimately served the Fish and Wildlife Service removed the concho water snake from the list. So a recovered species right here in Texas, you know, a win. Now I'm going to get into some of the species that we've got a number of things going on. I'd like to start out with one that garners a lot of public support, attention. It's a fun one to work with because folks are really captivated by it, and that's the monarch butterfly. You know, here's at the George W. Bush Presidential Center in Dallas, where First Lady Laura Bush, along with the director of the Fish and Wildlife Service, Texas Parks and Wildlife, National Wildlife Federation, and a host of other state agencies and other partners kicked off an initiative and effort to help the monarch species. And it's been a pleasure to work with, both assembling science but also getting good stuff on the ground. No bias here. That's my little girl down at Zilker, the Monarch Appreciation Day. Those of you who have kids, grandkids, great thing to do. Yeah, I'm not from Texas. My wife is from Texas. My daughter's a sixth-generation little Texan. And one of the things I really enjoy about working in Texas is the pride that folks have for their state. And I see that also carrying over to the natural heritage of the state, and brings pleasure working here. The Rio Grande, Rio Bravo, Ms. Combs was very helpful in this, going back to 2008 when we reintroduced the minnow and section of the Rio Grande out in the net by the national park where it once existed, and got them there. You know, we did it through a voluntary process. It reduced the regulatory restrictions, and it augments the population that's also in New Mexico. So positive things. Ms. Combs was very helpful in that, so thank you. Joy always you know, is always quick to point out your help that you've given us on that. Getting into the I-35 corridor, which was that place where, you know, that first paper that I pointed out said, you know, hotspot, lots of rare endemics. My sense of that is probably what's driving it is the Edwards Aquifer, just all kinds of little rare little bugs and critters that are found below the surface. That's my take on it in terms of where the sort of diversity is probably coming from. But anyhow, warblers, karst, invertebrates, the aquifer. And we have regional HCPs, plus Fort Hood, Camp Bullis, all along the I-35 corridor. Absolutely the innovative solution of the recovery accrediting system. Innovative solution here in Texas, lots of those to be proud of. The first regional Section 10 permit issued in the country here in Travis, Austin. Sort of paved the way for these voluntary Section 10 programs. Williamson County has one, Bastrop, Hayes, Comal. We've been working on one there in San Antonio, plus the Edwards. So here's some slides that I got from Williamson County, just to show you how some of these regional plans work. 100 participants since 2008, 6,655 acres of endangered species habitat being authorized to be taken. You know, caves being closed, those sorts of things, participation fees, other sources of public funding, they get that and in turn acquire preserves within the county. A lot of times I hear criticisms that these programs are making it easy for folks that want to get a permit, and I look at that and say, well, yes, that is true. Streamlining the process and providing regulatory certainty and reducing workload on everybody, I feel, is a good thing. These plans also look at a landscape scale, and you're more strategic, pool resources, and you're able to do things for these critters that you wouldn't otherwise be able to do on a piece-by-piece, postage stamp basis. Balcony's plan, y'all have heard it, 1996 was put in place. Over the years, 789 folks have, approached them. 283 have actually participated for, development, public infrastructure, 236, that's like 550 almost, resulted in $4.5 billion assessed value from those improvements through that plan. And again, it's not just all economics. They've acquired a number of preserves, what they've done is acquired lands, acquired an asset, physical asset for the community that they've made investments in. Whether those things do is a number of benefits to the community. Kids, 69 youth educational events just last year, 2,283 young people from schools going out to the preserves right here in Travis County, City of Austin. Remarkably, over the course of 3 years, there's been 285 events with 14,000 kids going out there. So a host of benefits. Edwards Aquifer. Southern segment, San Antonio's water supply, ag to the west, Springs communities, downstream interests, lots of conflict over that scarce resource over the years. What happened in 2006 is there was a stakeholder process that was kicked off. There would be meetings monthly with some 50 stakeholder groups attending. Here's an article actually going back to 1991 from San Antonio Light. No longer exists, but talking about the San Antonio and the water crisis. Well, things have changed. Now there's a regional plan that's in place. There's an incentive program where farmers can voluntarily lease water. It's an additional revenue stream if they choose. That water can go, goes to the springs. There's regulatory certainty for the city of San Antonio. They plan around downstream communities, downstream interests. The springs ultimately will keep flowing during a repeat of the drought of the record. That of course, didn't happen in the 50s, and Comal Springs would have went dry for 3 years straight without the plan. So a benefit to the community, a benefit to the state, benefit to these critters. Wild rice have doubled in their abundance since this plan was put in place. Of course, that water, a lot of it, during drought, is going to be important, certainly, for the hoopers. You've heard about that in the news too. Other things we do, work with a lot of private landowners. You know, here's some of the, it's similar to the USDA NRCS program. They're working with agriculture. We work with private landowners interested in, basically the wildlife enthusiasts, but a lot of interest in it. Here's an example down there by San Marcos. This is where a Texas blind salamander is, old well cave, paid money, got it better. You know, Houston toad, Bastrop. Do a lot of things out there. Landowners are interested in working with us because the management activities are not only good for the toad, but you clear brush, enhances the their property. It's good for Rio Grande turkeys. It's good for white-tailed deers. It's good for the toad. Reduces risk of potential catastrophic wildfire. All good things. So, Ms. Combs started the task force. Thank you. We are always trying to do better, and there is money there at the task force for research, and yes, Mrs. Combs is absolutely right that additional science for us is a good thing, and it helps us to focus on truly what the priorities are, and find out, in fact, if there is a problem, then perhaps we can get out in front, similar to the dune sagebrush lizard, and fix it. That pyramid shows a species status assessment process. You got the two triangles. One shows the old way that we used to do things, where you'd have some science on the bottom, lots of document prep, review, and then there's, you probably heard legendary surname process and review, all the way up through the department. This actually came about internally in Fish and Wildlife Service. This came from the biologists, this came from the folks that work on listing packages. They said the process is broken. We need to fix it. How do we get more to science? So the goal is to flip the pyramid. And the beauty of the task force is that we get to engage, partner with the state, all stakeholders to say, what are the things that are most important here? What are the priorities? How do we utilize the science in a very strategic fashion? And Fish and Wildlife Service engages very early on before things are being proposed. And here's how Fish and Wildlife Service does it. Here's a wise use of how the resources should be spent. So the information that you're looking at is going to best aid in a decision. So we got another lizard. Here. Spot-tailed earless lizard. Found out in the Eagleford and also out in the Permian Basin. And this is one where we did a positive 90-day finding. No date has been scheduled on a 12-month finding, but where a lot of resources from the comptroller's office have been invested into this one, using the SSA framework as a way to allocate science, resources, research in a way that best helps us all understand what's out there in the most transparent fashion. If it's a priority, how do we fix it? If not, there's a lot of others that may need our help. Last thing, got to end it on a positive. I got a largemouth there, talking about the fish. Rob asked me, how long I worked for Fish and Wildlife Service. Started when I was 23, worked for a number of states. Started, when I knew what I wanted to do. That's the reason why. I love to fish, love to be in the outdoors, and that's ultimately, I think, why we're all interested in this, is passing our natural heritage, our natural resources onto future generations. And so with that, thank you.
Adam, you got a beautiful little girl. That's cute. Thank you very much. Next, I'm very pleased to introduce our third panelist here with us today from a few states over in Colorado. My friend William Perry Pendley joins us. Mr. Pendley is the President and Chief Operating Officer of Mountain States Legal Foundation. During the Reagan administration, he served as the Deputy Assistant Secretary for Energy and Minerals of the Department of Interior, where he authored President Reagan's National Minerals Policy and the Exclusive Economic Zone Proclamation. Mr. Pendley received his BA and master's degrees in economics and political science from George Washington University in Washington, D.C. Please help me welcome Mr. Pendley.
Greater sage grouse is the largest grouse in North America. Its range once extended over 165 million acres in 11 states, not including Texas. Since 1999, environmental groups tried to put it on the endangered species list, and consistently the Fed said no, it's not justified. So the environmental groups filed lawsuits, filed litigation to say Forest Service, change your plans, US BLM, change your plans. Usually when I talk to a Texas audience, I have to explain about the BLM, but you've got the Red River controversy in which Rob is involved, the foundation, and so you know what a fine agency is, the BLM. So change your plans because you have not made allowance for the sage grouse. Then in 2010, the administration concluded, this administration, that the sage grouse was, its listing was warranted, but not justified given other more important priorities. Well, the governors of western states got the news. They got the message, and they were nervous that bad things would happen, bad things akin to what happened in the Pacific Northwest over the northern spotted owl. Now, if you've not followed that battle, you know that it shut down logging in the Pacific Northwest. 60,000 people in Oregon alone lost their jobs because the environmentalists concluded, asserted, and the Fish and Wildlife Service concluded that, in fact, logging hurt the owl. There was a report just issued last month in December saying it was not the logging after all. Sorry, we bad. It's the barred owl. The population of the northern spotted owl is still in decline. So our western governors became concerned. They engaged in the kinds of voluntary conservation mechanisms you've heard about, and so thorough and so exhaustive and so far-reaching were those plans that in September of last year, the Secretary of Interior, Sally Jewell, said, hey, you've really achieved great things with your voluntary conservation plans. There'll be no listing of the sage grouse. That was great news, but it drowned out the very thing that happened at the same time, and that was the Bureau of Land Management and the Forest Service announced brand new rules on how they're going to manage western land. And the rules say that there will be a net conservation gain for any activity that takes a place on federal land. Now, you may have noticed Obama's executive order on the subject. This is an incredibly far-reaching policy, and not just far-reaching, but illegal. Because federal law says that if you have activity on federal land, if it's grazing your cattle or mining or doing oil and gas activities, well then if it's undue or unnecessary degradation of the land, then you must mitigate. But what the agencies are now saying is because of the sage grouse, any activity you've got to mitigate for it. You've got to make allowance for it. Now, in addition, the agencies came forward that very same day that Sally Jewell made her announcement and said, we're going to withdraw 10 million acres of federal land in highly mineralized areas throughout the American West from mining operations because of the sage grouse. So here we're told by the federal government, you've achieved great success, western states, but we're still going to implement these draconian rules nonetheless. No surprise, the governor of Idaho, the Idaho legislature sued. Two counties in Nevada sued. One county, Elko County, stands to lose $31 million a year in ag activity and mining and oil and gas activities. Attorney General Laxalt got involved in the lawsuit, and then Mountain States Legal Foundation, on behalf of the Wyoming Stockbrokers Association, sued up in Wyoming. Folks, I want to tell you, if this is victory, then I don't want to see defeat. Now, The problem is, let's take a hard look at the sage grouse, and maybe that's what the governor should have done. Maybe what the governor should have done is, instead of bending over backwards and adopting these conservation plans, they should have sued, because the data is simply not there with regard to the sage grouse. And I talk about the governor suing and taking a page out of the environmental group's book. I wrote this book on Ronald Reagan, Sagebrush Rebel, Reagan's battle with environmental extremists and why it matters today, laid out what Reagan did, what happened next, and what's going on today, and how the Endangered Species Act changed from a regulatory thing where the Fish and Wildlife Service was in the driver's seat to a situation in which litigation drives the implementation of the Endangered Species Act. As one of the environmental extremists said, we're crazy to sit in trees when we have this wonderful law, the Endangered Species Act, to force people to do what we want to do. And the scientific studies that were made with regard to the sage grouse demonstrate, and I'm talking about studies that go all the way back to 1978, simply there was data error after data error after data error, 12 separate kinds of data error with regard to what they call these leaks or these courting grounds that are used by the grouse. In addition, there were, worst of all, math errors. I guess the Fish and Wildlife Service doesn't do math. And it comes out of the nature of the Endangered Species Act. And I want to comment on something Rob said. It is blatantly unconstitutional. The authority of the Congress is the authority to regulate interstate commerce. And when you have species that are isolated, say the cave bug here in Texas, in two counties in Texas, and nowhere else on the planet, and nobody gives a good guard darn about them, then you don't have a species in interstate commerce. And yet the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals say, oh yeah, under the Elton John circle of life situation, they were all connected. And so therefore, the law is constitutional. You also have a situation where the law is so controversial that it is expired. It is sunset. It is no longer on the books. It is maintained every year with an appropriation from Congress. Well, this bad science began with Jack Ward Thomas back in the spotted owl days. Jack Ward Thomas was allegedly the expert on spotted owls, and he was asked by a reporter, what's the magic number? How many sage grouse or sand dune lizards do we need? How many spotted owls, he was asked, do we need? And he said, there is no magic number. We're making moral judgments as to the needs of man and the needs of critters. Well, we don't need the Fish and Wildlife Service making moral judgments, as far as I'm concerned. I debated the regional director of the Fish and Wildlife Service on USA Today several years ago, and I complained that there was bad science involved. And he said, well, we are using science, he said. I don't think he was joking. He said, but it's political science. Well, political science or junk science or weird science, whatever you want to call it. Traditionally, scientific findings meant reproducible findings. You do an experiment, you come to a conclusion, that worked, you do it again. Did it work again? Is it scientific? But instead, the Fish and Wildlife Service, and we see this in the sage grouse, uses models. What will the world look like in 30 years? What will the world look like in 100 years? Therefore, we listed the polar bear. Now, the Fish and Wildlife Service studies, they're incestuous, they're self-serving, they rely on data on the internet. For example, environmental groups have data posted on the internet, data, and the data you can't find. Well, what's the underlying data? How did you come up with that number? Something you would think would be fundamental, we'd like to see what it is. The greatest deficiency, says Rob Roy Ramey, and Dr. Rob Roy Ramey is a well-acknowledged expert on endangered species. He travels the world. He said, trying to put myself out of a job by finding ways to recover these species. And the problem with the Fish and Wildlife Service is a conflict of interest that's affected a groupthink, confirmational bias, and a common desire to preserve their power, prestige, and the annual appropriations they get from Congress. Now, I'll give you an example. We had a monograph done on the sage grouse. There's a monograph done on the sage grouse. It was held up to us. Here's our news information on the sage grouse. 41% of the authors were federal employees. The editor was a federal employee, and he had written a third of the articles. Where's the peer review in that? Ask any scientist. Is that the way things are supposed to go? No, they're not. I'll give you another example, and it's the Preble's Meadow jumping mouse. This is a curious mouse in Wyoming and Colorado that was used by the left to get listed in 98 and shut down activity from Casper, Wyoming, all the way down I-25 down to Colorado Springs. And Ramey said about what he calls the so-called Preble's jumping mouse, there's no consistent threshold, so the Fish and Wildlife Service listings are highly subjective. And with regard to the mouse, he said, There is no measurable difference between it and other purported subspecies of meadow jumping mice. It's less than among the difference of mouse in the same species, unquote. And in fact, the scientist who came up with the data, who reached the conclusion we ought to list the mouse, disavowed his conclusion. Denver Post reported on this in 2014 and saying, we found these indistinct mice all the way from Colorado up through Canada and into Alaska. Well, to paraphrase Hillary Clinton, what difference does it make? Well, it does make a big difference, because in 2012, 2007, in the height of the Preble's Meadow jumping mouse controversy, we spent more as a nation for the Preble's Meadow jumping mouse, a phony species, a make-believe species, than we did to try to save the blue whale. Now, the blue whale is really an endangered species. It's been saved in the Atlantic, but not in the Pacific. There are technological fixes that we could use to help mitigate and save the species for sure, but we're not doing that because we're spending it on the mouse. Now, the London Zoological Society has come up with a program it calls EDGE. And the EDGE program is evolutionarily distinct and globally endangered. And they have a list of the 100 most endangered species. Where do you think the Preble's Meadow jumping mouse is on that list? 4,200. That's where it is on the list, and here we are standing on our heads to it. And why are we standing on our heads with regard to the Preble's Meadow jumping mouse? Because environmentalists don't like the growth that was taking place in suburban Denver, Colorado, wanted to find a way to shut it down. Just as, in my view, trying to use the greater prairie chicken and the dunes sagebrush lizard. There are other problems. And I'll give you some specific, and your head starts to spin when you talk about some of these things. Why do we have a two-bag limit on sage grouse in Wyoming and Montana? You can go, come on up and get a license and kill them. But they'll shut down oil and gas activity over in Sublette County, Wyoming, or grazing by our ranchers. Secondly, you have this thing called peripheral populations. And that is populations of species that have settled in areas outside their normal range during unusual climactic conditions, and now those climactic conditions are changing, and the species is in retreat, and the environmental groups come in, and the Fish and Wildlife Service comes in and said, oh, it's in danger, we got to save it, we got to bring it back. A good example is the Canadian lynx. At one time, it was deep in southern Colorado, and then climate warmed up a little bit, and all of a sudden it was in retreat. Well, we got to bring it back. We've got to spend tens of millions of dollars to bring it back. All those that they brought back are dead now. And the third one is the use of our boundaries, our borders, with foreign countries to pick a species and say, hey, this is something we got to protect, even though it's in abundance somewhere else. I'll give you an example. The coastal California gnatcatcher, a bird, there's 6,000 pairs in Southern California. There's 3.2 million pairs in Baja. And yet, in Southern California, they're standing on their heads to try to accommodate that. Well, let's go back to our title, Mission Accomplished, and what should happen after a protected species recovers. And maybe we shouldn't talk about recovery. I'm a lawyer, so I'm going to quibble. Maybe we should say removed. And we have removed species. Rob said 31 species out of 2,100. Oh, good for us. The bald eagle, the peregrine falcon, the California brown pelican, all removed. But not because of the Endangered Species Act and great success for the Fish and Wildlife Service. We stopped using DDT. And that's why those species came back. Let's talk about the peregrine falcon, delisted in 1999. They're supposed to monitor for 5 years. Instead, they monitored for 15 years. And yet the restrictions, the land use restrictions with regard to peregrine falcon, is still in place in places like Yosemite in California, Jefferson County, and my home in Colorado, my current residence in Colorado, and their restrictions that continue to be imposed. And it raises yet another issue, that even when the feds take it off the list, it's still on the state list, and you still have state regulatory authority. As a species recovers, for example, the peregrine falcon, its range is going to expand. For example, the peregrine falcon in Scotland is now to be found in low cliffs and rubble piles. Are we going to protect those two? When we go out and find peregrine falcons in rubble piles and low cliffs, we say, well, we've got to have restrictions there. And the question is, at what cost? At what cost? Will Rogers once said, it's not the stuff that we don't know that causes us such problems, it's the stuff we know that ain't true. And I cite that for the Fish and Wildlife Service's perennial problem of listing species incorrectly. The Pacific Legal Foundation, like Rob's group here and my group up in Colorado, sued the Fish and Wildlife Service for the Modoc sucker listing, a listing back in 1985, said you were wrong. In 2009, the Fish and Wildlife Service did another study and said, we bad, you're right, didn't merit listing, we'll fix. Finally, in 2011, Pacific Legal Foundation petitions once again and says, hey, implement your study. You already concluded you were wrong. Do it. Fish and Wildlife Service did nothing. Finally, Pacific sued in 2013 saying, do your job. And then last month, the Fish and Wildlife Service, with great fanfare, announces we have saved the Modoc sucker and we can take it off the list. Well, it hadn't saved it at all. It made a mistake. And worst of all, it was late in publishing it because it forgot to publish notice in a local newspaper. Let me give you one final comment, and it's a comment informed by what's going on in Harney County, Oregon today. And if you don't know, turn on the internet. Because what happened up there is a couple of ranchers were sent to federal prison because they started a backfire on their property to protect their property from a wildfire, and it swept onto federal lands. Typically, what happens in those circumstances is they are charged with, properly, a trespass. Instead, in this case, they were charged with terrorism. And the mandatory minimum sentence for doing that is 5 years in jail, and that's where they are right now. And it raises the specter of the federal government. And that's why I see bumper stickers all over the American West that say, I love my country, but I fear my government. And now let me apply that to the Endangered Species Act. We represented a man who killed a grizzly bear in self-defense. He was attacked and he responded, he was armed and he saved his own life. And for 8 years, the Fish and Wildlife Service prosecuted him, arguing alternatively, he didn't really act in self-defense. He has to meet a self-defense standard as if he killed a human being. He's at fault because he went outside with a gun. He's at fault because he took his dog with him and his dog went on point and provoked the bear and escalated the conflict. And finally, the bears are entitled to a higher standard of self-defense because they're not capable of sapient thought. It took us 8 years and $225,000 to win that case. And now the kicker. A couple of years later, a man by the name of Pat Van Fleet went hunting in Du Bois, Wyoming, and was nearly killed by a bear. And he was nearly killed because he laid his rifle down and tried to respond with pepper spray. And I called him up after he recovered, and I said, what in the world were you thinking about? And he said, I tried to be nice, but, you know. And he said, Perry, I'd heard about your case, and I didn't want that to happen to me. This is a fearsome situation, folks, when somebody fears his government more than he fears the most dangerous killing machine in North America. Let me conclude with a commercial, and that is, I have brought copies of my book, Sagebrush Rebel, Reagan's Battle. If you haven't read it, it's a great book about what he did, and it informs us today on how we ought to respond. And I know you have long driving distances in Texas, so it's on tape. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. And we have time now for question and answer. We'll have a microphone being passed around for questions here in the room, and I'm going to lead off in citing to a recent article published by our friend Brian Seashell's Reason Foundation, talking about the anniversary of the Endangered Species Act. Mr. Seashell discussed how under the Endangered Species Act framework, in situations you have landowners that destroy habitat before it can be found out that they have endangered species so that they won't come under the regulation. And some of the discussions that we've had here today, Ms. Combs talked about the dune sagebrush lizard where 21 biologists were hired in a large effort to contest the listing of a species. And Mr. Pendley and Mr. Zerrenner have discussed the litigation and a lot of the efforts that have been fought over the Endangered Species Act. And so my question to the panel is, now that we are looking retroactively over 43 years of the Endangered Species Act, has the experiment of federal government regulation of species, is it a failed experiment, or in the alternative, is there a case to be made for another 40 years of the federal government regulating endangered species?
Let me start by saying I think what we've seen so far in the past is that I don't think there was a good standard for science. And if you're going to use science as a way to list something and it's so-called best available science, and that can really mean no science, if there isn't any, then I think that's a major problem. I think, secondly, I think that the petition process is so open-ended for fish and wildlife that I think it has been hijacked by some folks, which is why I gave you the example of 1,300 since 2007, which is more than the prior 30 years. And so you have, no matter how well-written or well-intended or well-thought-out the act was number of years ago, when you have the framework under the Administrative Procedures Act, et cetera, you ended up with a very flawed mechanism. I would say, thirdly, that when you do have people who are more afraid of their government than of being killed by a bear, I think we have actually turned things on its head. I don't imagine anybody in the American public would say you should just stand there and get consumed by a grizzly bear because you might face time in the federal slammer. And so I'm not arguing about whether or not there should be some protection. I think it's a fine idea, and I think people do behave responsibly. But I think it has gotten distorted. I think it has been torqued, and I think the very poor requirements for science have got to be revisited. I think the petition process has to become transparent, and I think the sue and settlement process has to become very, very open, because you end up with those people who have to have basically no requirements of any kind, except you write your name and say that you've got an interest in being able to petition. And you don't have to establish a baseline of the data that you attach. And so unless somebody's prepared to challenge it, the petitioner's information trumps.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm going to speak to two things. One is your question, one of your questions, Rob, as well as a point that Mrs. Combs just made regarding the petition process. As a disincentive for private landowners to want to provide information or destroy habitat in advance of a potential listing, is that a problem? I would say absolutely. I would love to see incentives and built in to policies or however that landowners would say, yes, I've got one of these critters, and guess what? It's like having a piece of gold. So you don't have the fear and concern about, an example of that here is Bastrop County. And, there's the state passed a tax law that if a landowner, the traditional wildlife and ag exemption, if they have an endangered species permit, they can have a temporary easement, they get property tax reductions. It's incentive. Folks want to sign up for it? Absolutely. Those kinds of things are just, especially in a private lands environment, I see is just critical. In terms of the petition process, Fish and Wildlife Service last May published a proposed reg change that will, what it said was, if you're petitioning Fish and Wildlife Service to list a species, one, you have to coordinate with the states. You have to go to your state fish and game agency and say, we'd like to have all the science. And also, it ends the process where people send in these petitions that have sparse information and they have hundreds of species built into the petition. Because it's going to be just for single species. So you have to coordinate with the states, and you have to limit it to one species. Getting back to that map I showed, you can imagine that we got a 475 species petition. We said no on most of it, and a lot of it was found right in that area. And the information was highly limited, and hence the reason why we rejected much of it. This process will make that standard, assuming that it's finalized, more clear. So I guess, answer your questions, petition process, proposed reg change, we're working on fixing it, and two, I'd love to see folks non-fearful and actually, you know, if there'd be incentives for folks to want to do the opposite.
I don't think Congress ever intended to do what has happened, because at the time they were talking about 100 species. That's what the conversation was, 100 species. Now we got thousands, and we've gone from protecting the warm and fuzzies to protecting the cold and slimies. I think that the people who voted, and it was passed almost unanimously, would be shocked to see what's going on. The second thing is, the Fish and Wildlife Service has always had the ability to reject these petitions if they have more than one species included. And for years, this Endangered Species, the Fish and Wildlife Service should have been rejecting these petitions. Congress ought to do its job. It's the same with almost everything that we talk about. Congress ought to do its job. It's not doing its job. It's not doing effective oversight. And it's distorting things. I think one of the points that Brian made in that article of his was when you stand on your head with regard to, say, the Preble's Meadow jumping mouse, you give up other priorities. There's other things that aren't being done. If you're saying, well, I'm going to make my land a great habitat for X, then Y and Z, they're not going to be there anymore. And that's the very nature of evolution. It's the very nature of millions of species have gone out of existence. And maybe some of them should.
Mr. Sparks?
Yeah, I'd like to ask, I'm going to make a quick comment. Mr. Zerrenner showed a map that originally you had less science, and now you're supposedly got better science that you've used in coming up with a species that needs to be listed. 20 years ago, we had spotted owl. That was on your early map. And just recently, we had the sagebrush lizard in the Permian Basin. In both instances, your scientific was absolutely unfounded and wasn't good. So it doesn't look like to me you've made any changes at all. And then my question is to any of the panel members, and I may be wrong, but I'd like to know. My understanding was originally the species was supposed to be limited to federal lands. Is that correct or not correct? And if it is, how the heck did it get to where it's now on public property?
Well, I believe that it was originally intended to be on just federal lands, and that was when you look at the legislative history, as I have, with the passage of that law. Number one, they thought it was going to be about 100 species. Number two, they thought that it would be on federal lands. This was an issue on federal lands and where most of the species were, after all. And the third thing was, they said, well, if it ever affects private property, well, then we'd we have to use somebody's property for this. We have a taking of their property without just compensation. Well, we'll just provide just compensation. And in my experience, I know of no situation in which any landowner has been compensated for the presence of an endangered species. They sort of live with it. Now, you can make the case that Congress does have the authority to regulate private property, but only under its Commerce Clause authority. And that's where I'm sure at the time Congress was thinking, just as it did with regard to the Clean Water Act, say, in defining waters of the United States, well, the Congress gives the authority to the agency to act to the degree that it has that authority under the Commerce Clause. Well, when you have a court that looks the other way on those things and broadly defines or ignores the restriction on Commerce Clause, and we have yet to have the Supreme Court of the United States agree to hear one of those cases, and I look forward to that day. But until that time, the agency will continue to do these activities on private property to the detriment of landowners.
Next, Kathleen.
Yes. I live in Bastrop County, where in 2011, the horrific drought and unusual weather conditions produced a fire that was pretty much within the footprint of the critical habitat of the toad, of the Houston toad. 1,700 homes were destroyed. I sat not too long ago, less than a year, next to the county commissioner in charge for basic safety response immediately after the fire and ultimately all recovery, who testified to Congress about what she called the disaster within the disaster, in that the way it turned out was that the
the toad issues. The minute FEMA funds started flowing, there arrived, and perhaps you were involved with some of that, but lots of biologists. And anyway, she testified that it took twice as long and twice the amount of money for the initial recovery. The Act has no, unless those on the panel are more informed than I, no way of balancing something like threats to human safety after a natural disaster and the needs of the species. I've always thought, and I'd love to hear this again, this expert panel, that the problem with the Act was that there was no balancing at all. The needs of the species, unequivocally, I use that word self-consciously, came before human beings. In case law established in 1978 that regarded the snail darter, and Tennessee Valley Authority, that is still good case law, as I understand, which said very clearly that the needs of the species, and that's, of course, complicating factors in situations like Mr. Christie's, and that itself, that one Congress is, it's easy to say Congress can put a balancing mechanism in something and perhaps the problem's not over, but I think there's what might be a strong consensus of voters in this country that in natural disasters, threats to human life and limb actually preempt the need of the species. And I'd just love to hear your comments.
You're absolutely right, and we've seen that situation in Southern California, and we've seen that situation elsewhere. The case you're referring to, of course, is TVA versus Hill, and this was the very first Supreme Court decision with regard to the Endangered Species Act. And one of the fascinating things, and we're informed by the notes that were taken by the various justices, and then after their death, and those records were opened up, and we saw some of the debate that took place. And essentially, the court, the justices said among themselves, if Congress is so stupid as to do something like this, let's hoist them on their own petard. Let's just show them. You want to do something, and the phrase is, regardless of the cost. Okay, you're going to write a law that says regardless of the cost? We'll uphold that, and you can live with it. And the dissent by Potter Stewart from Virginia was fascinating because he had all the figures, all the costs that were involved, all the millions that had been spent to build Tellico Dam. And he said, we're really going to flush all this down the toilet because of this species? That makes no sense. And the other justices said, well, let Congress live with it. And Congress was given the opportunity to change it, and instead they declined to change it. And they initiated for the first time with Tellico Dam the God Squad. And in fact, the Secretary of the Interior at the time said, no, we shouldn't use the God Squad. We shouldn't overrule the Endangered Species Act. And we've been living with it ever since. And I think I think the Supreme Court justices wanted to hold Congress's feet to the fire. And it frankly didn't work. And we're living with the results.
Ms. Combs, Mr. Zerrenner.
I wasn't involved in the FEMA federal funding and those monitors. Heard a little bit about it, so I can't speak to the specifics. To the extent that it was causing delays, that is unfortunate. In terms of life, you know, human safety, does it come first? Yes. If there's an emergency, then yes. When those fires occurred in 2011, there was also concerns about landowners that live adjacent to warbler habitat. So to try to, in the future, come up with a way that folks would not be concerned about clearing potential warbler habitat, I worked with the fire crew out at Balcones and wrote a short permit to them and said, all you got to do is talk to these folks for technical assistance and you're covered. You can put fire breaks in. They're talking to the fire department and so on. And so just, how can we... In the end of the day, one, human safety, and if the warbler habitat burns up, it's not good for birds either.
Last thought, Ms. Combs?
Just one comment. I want an email that goes out that says, if you are faced with a grizzly, a cougar, a boa constrictor on the march, you get a free pass from Fish and Wildlife because it's an emergency.
Hey, that's got to come from the Department of Justice, too.
Adam, go ahead.
I have hiked in grizzly country, and yeah, the only thing I can say is, yeah, it surprises me to hear what y'all have said, because yeah, I've been up in Glacier and sure, you know, some of those trails that are the high risk trails.
Squirt honey on the guy you're running with.
Texas solution.
This has been terrific. We are out of time today. Susan, Adam, Perry, thank you very much. Please help me thanking our panelists here today.